Richie Benno.
Of the final day's play of this Cornhill Test series, the last day of the Headingley Test between England and Pakistan. Not much play promised, even though the conditions were very good at the start of play, because Pakistan needed only 4 wickets to clinch this match, and England, for their part, had to go from 190 for 6 up to 219 for their victory. Yesterday afternoon, those wickets taken as the light deteriorated by Madassa and Imran Khan were very much to the detriment of England's scorecard, and their bowling figures were most impressive. The two bowlers not to take a wicket were Sikandar and Abdul Qadir. Imran Khan, 3 for 54, and Madassa, 3 for 46, did all the damage. First thing this morning, the very first ball of the day, in fact, those two great all-rounders, Imran Khan and Ian Botham, were in opposition.
On that balcony than the Pakistan manager into Kabbalah. So Botham yet to open the score. Well, that's nudged away nice and quietly. Two comfortable runs in that. And Ian Botham off the mark. I think Mark's looking quite cool and calm at that end, but I'd imagine that it's a fair amount of nervous strain and tension as well. Nice job of Meander at second slip. And that's gone through 4 very valuable buys again, and extras have played such an important part in this game. Takes them up to 34. And quite a high percentage of buys.
Yes, and a very important 4 runs for England. That really hasn't gone very wide of Wasimbari. Without being unkind, I think he should have stopped that. Very quick delivery this. Wide, but making him both and play at it.
Quite a defensive field of Pakistan, unable to give any easy runs away here. And that's pushed away quite confidently by Marks. He's in his first run of the morning. Not an unusual position for Vic Marks, because a lot of his good 50s for Somerset have been made in the late middle order when his side have been struggling. Straight away, not further by Gatham. We're looking for 2 here. By Sikandar Bhatt, but Botham earned the urgency and need to run the first one quickly. Oh, and he's gone. Oh, Madassa's taken him. And Margit again, coolest of customers, taking a very good catch low down to his left. So a great blow for Pakistan. Botham goes for four, caught Margit, bowled Modassa to give Modassa his fourth wicket. 199 for seven.
And what a remarkable game this is. Modassa usually slants the ball in, making that one leave the bat, bounces a little bit and hits the shoulder. And Majid picks up a comfortable catch there.
So this game's not finished with yet, by any means.
And here you can see that delivery just bounce a little bit. In fact, hit the glove. So a very, very good delivery from Modassa there.
So Bob Taylor taking guard and Modassa turning out to be the secret weapon. Staggered everybody with his six wickets at Lord's. Most people thinking he could never ever reproduce that again, and here he is with four more. Put the stamp on that run, every run vital. A good pick up, a fine throw, but Taylor very comfortably home. And here, he questions every decision, it seems. It's his enthusiasm more than anything else. So that brings up 200 on the board. Applause for that, and for another excellent over from Modassa. 4 for 50 is figures now from 19 overs. Up, we'll now be giving it everything he's got. Slipped a more attacking field in two now, the forward short leg, the short leg behind, up for the catch. Two slips, and the third slip quite wide. Wisely taking no chances, he's kept the third man. Again, it's four more buys. That a very difficult one, in fact, for Wadim Bari.
And absolutely no blame can be attached to Wasim for that. Imran running in trying to bowl very, very fast. That hits the foothold at the back of the crease and flies high over Wasim's head. 42
out of 204. A very, very vital factor in this game. So the margin now down to 15. 15 wanted, 3 wickets in hand. Imran to Taylor. Very, very close again to the outside edge. A little bit of a nibble at that one. Thank you. best with four singles to date. Shot he tried to play late last night to Madassa and nearly lost his off stump. Didn't look very elegant on the replay.
And a pretty useful ball too, curving in at that pace. Not many very fast bowlers have been able to swing the ball both ways, and this man can. It took Ray Lindwell a long time to be able to get it to go both ways.
Ball swinging in Yorker this time. Two really excellent balls there to start this over.
Well, this is the ball every fast bowler looking to bowl in swinging right up in the block hole. Magnificent. In fact, Marks did well to have something in the way of it.
Wondering what's coming next. I think a shot again would be causing some problems on the players' balcony. Superstitious lot. As a breed of cricketers, they're probably all locked in the dressing room. Not watching. Oh, what a good over this is. What a torrid time Vic Marks is having.
Vic Marks did even better to keep this out, because that was the ball, literally burning the batting crease. He just got the toe end of the bat down on it.
Well, there's the England batter, not a soul in sight. I doubt whether IMRAN, the whole of the series, has bowled a better over than this. Desperately pleased that he's a non-striker at the moment. Still 11 wanted, and England being made to battle for every single one of them. Turn now to face IMRAN. Oh, that's a good shot. Very coolly steered square on the offside. To the other fielder, and one is enough. Put off by that change of style from IMRAN coming around the wicket.
Well, this switch of tactics, I think slightly in IMRAN's mind, is that he'll get a better foothold bowling from that side. He's had trouble with the footmarks on the other side, but looking at it from the batsman's point of view, Vic Marks, I would think, would be a little happier to have the ball coming from around there. The danger of that one skidding low is much less.
Just away on to third man. Could you again the fielder? considerable figures. In fact, it's some little time since we had an England batsman in double figures. Tavery, Fowler and Gattin, the only three. And Lamb, Gower, Botham and Randall, all in turn out in single figures. Two runs here. And sighs of relief, I'm sure, inside that dressing room now. Rather fancy that one or two might even be looking through the window at this stage. And the bowl is just two men on the leg side. Cadillo's come right the way up from third man to go to mid-wicket. At long leg, which has meant Zahir has to cross Headingley ground to take up his position at third man now. So this might well be the last and final fling for Imran Khan. Taylor to face. That's stroked away nicely. That's going to bring the scores level. And two to Taylor. And of course from the crowd. And needs a hat-trick in the next three balls to tie this match. And very obviously now, everybody comes up to save the singles. Zahir comes up from third man, and Sewell comes up from long leg. That bit of relief up there. One or two of the England players appearing as Imran comes in to Taylor. That's it. He's made doubly sure. He's nudged it away. It'll race through for four runs. But one is enough. This is the end of one of the most enthralling contests we've had for a very long time. Great end to the series with England finally triumphing by the margin of three wickets. Thanks to that stubborn little partnership at the end by Marks and Taylor.
And in years to come, people will look at that scorecard and say, well, England did it quite comfortably. Well, it wasn't that way at all. There were a lot of nerves around the ground, and particularly, I suspect, in the England dressing room, once Ian Botham was dismissed for that safe catch by Marjadorf Madassa for only four. 42 extras in that 222, and I can tell you one thing about one of the not-out batsmen, Vic Marks. He'll remember that 12 not-out for the rest of his days. The bowling figures for Pakistan. The extra wicket this morning to Madassa Nazar, 4 for 55, and Imran Khan, 3 for 69. He bowled his heart out, but it wasn't quite good enough to achieve victory for Pakistan, and England just went ahead in the series 2-1. Imran Khan, in this match, went to 21 wickets in the three-match series, thus beating Fazal Mahmood's record of 20 in four matches way back in 1954. And if you have a look at the figures Imran Khan achieved in this match, as he was presented with the Man of the Match award and the Man of the Series award by Tom Graveney, then you can see just why he was so impressive. He made 67 not out. Then he took 5 for 49 from 25.2 overs, then made 46 and was last man out in Pakistan's second innings, took 3 for 69 from 30.2 overs, and in all, the England batsman could only take fractionally over 2 runs per over off him, and he took 8 wickets as well. A tremendous performance from him. And after the match, and while the celebrations were being prepared, Peter West had the chance to talk to Imran Khan, and first of all, to Bob Willis.
Bob and Imran, what a finish. What a match. And what a series. Bob, as winning captain, and you undefeated since you took on the England captaincy in one day and in test, tremendous start.
Yeah, we're obviously overjoyed, Peter. It was marvellous test match series, one of the best I've ever played in. And I think, you know, with our resources, we lost 15 players at the start of the season, and I think the selectors and the guys who have been picked have done a marvellous job for us in adverse circumstances. I think a lot of credit is due to them.
Imran, congratulations on winning the man of the series and the man of the match. I imagine you would be willing to cede both of those to somebody else if you've been able to win here today.
Yes, definitely, Peter, because it's my first time as a captain, and I was hoping that we'd win the series, because I don't think by the next time Pakistan team comes over here, I'll be playing cricket. So it was going to be such a great ambition to win the series.
Can we go back to the position yesterday when England were winning easily, as it seems? They were 158 for one, and then suddenly you got Graham Fowler out and the light was getting murky, and England for a time wanted to go on batting, and then you suddenly saw a chance, didn't you?
Well, actually, at the Leeds wicket, one always feels that you can get a few wickets very quickly. It's a question, if two people get in, it's not easy to get a breakthrough, because the ball beats the back. The wicket is really, I mean, every ball doesn't do anything, the odd ball does something. But we always felt that once we got a wicket, we'd have two or three wickets fall quickly.
And then you produced your demon, Mudassar, again.
Yeah. I feel bad I haven't used him more.
Bob, what was the atmosphere like in the England dressing room as the wicket started to slip away last night? No doubt you had your pads on ready to give another splendid exhibition of bats, would you?
Oh, it was totally relaxed in there, Peter, wasn't it? Of course. No, it was very tense, and Tom Graveney really has said all that needs to be said about this gentleman, but I think his performance in this series has been monumental. And I think if he'd had the support from his senior batsmen that he deserved, then the result might have been differently. I mean, he batted more responsibly than probably anyone on the Pakistan side, and that, as well as having to do virtually all the seam bowling himself, is great credit to him. A wonderful cricketer.
I think we ought to have a word about Graham Fowler's innings of 86.
Well, yes, it was a remarkable innings from someone playing in their first test match. A marvellously inspired selection. Yes, I think we expect an awful lot of people when they play in their first game, and Graham responded marvellously. I thought it was a super innings, and he showed some of our senior batsmen the way to do it.
What was your reaction to Graham Fowler's performance, Imran?
I thought I was most impressed by him. He's not scared to play his shot. He's got a good technique, and I hope he'll do well in Australia, because it's nice to see a stroke player come on.
And on Australia, perhaps we can have the last word from Bob Willis, looking forward to the winter and the sunshine.
Well, yes, it's going to be a very hard tour, Peter. There's one or two of the Australians who are playing out their careers, waiting for us to arrive. Dennis Lilly and Greg Chappell, and I should think Tomo will be getting off his surfboard and coming to meet us again. It'll be a very hard trip. But if we can get the right blend of a touring party together, I think we'll give a good account of ourselves.
Well, Bob Willis is a realist, and although he's beaten Pakistan, not by very much, admittedly, and he's beaten India, he knows that things down under will be just that little bit tougher. Geoff Thompson on a surfboard. Well, Tom has been training since late July, but he is going to Pakistan with the Australian side shortly. So it'll remain to be seen how fit he is when he gets back to Australia. I do know that Lily's been training since the 1st of June, and that Greg Chappell is not going to Pakistan, so he'll be ready for England when they arrive out there on October 15. Rodney Marsh is there as well, and an enthusiastic young side intent on reversing what happened at Headingley, Edgbaston and Manchester last year when England retained the Ashes. A tremendous performance then, and we're hoping for a tremendous series down in Australia. Bob Willis, no one could have done a better job for England than Willis when he was brought in as captain this year. He beat India, beat Pakistan, won all the limited overs matches, and quite rightly, he holds aloft the trophy of this series.
Rolling back the years to present another favourite from the past. It's an episode of Maigret with...